Hey everyone, today in this video, we are going to talk about designing a messaging system just like WhatsApp. It's a chat system. So our systems like WhatsApp, Facebook Messenger, Line, WeChat, those are the systems we are trying to build today. And in these systems, there are basically two users who are chatting with each other and they are exchanging chat messages with them. As with any design system, let's go through the requirements first and let's see what all requirements we are going to fill via this system. So the first requirement is, since this is a chat system, so we have to provide one-to-one chat with the between the two users. Along with the one-to-one chat, we can also provide group chats. So there's a single group, and when a message is sent from a user, the message is sent to all the members of the group. That's our second requirement. The third requirement that we are trying to solve is the last seen. So the one user is able to see the last seen of the second user, like when the other user was online last. The fourth requirement is the chat history. So we are trying to persist chat in the history. We will not go very much detail into this, but we will touch upon it. The notifications, if two people are chatting and one is not online, so a notification has to be sent by some another mechanism, right? When I say not online, it may be like the user is, it's not that user is not connected to internet, it's like user's client is not online. So the client on the mobile phone or the app on the mobile phone is not running. It might be in the background, it might be killed by the OS or something like that, but the user is connected to the internet, but the app is not online. So that's how we will handle via notifications. And the last one is the receipt. So whenever two people are chatting and one sends a message to another, we'll try to send receipts to each other, like if the message is sent, if the message is delivered, if the message is seen by the other guy, like that. So yeah, these are the six requirements that we are trying to solve. Then there are some non-functional requirements, which is like the messaging should be real-time as fast as possible. If I send a message to another one, the guy should receive the message in real-time. Like it should not be like I send a message today and he's receiving tomorrow, right? So that's our first non-functional requirement. The second one could be like the system should scale, like the number of users on the chatting applications increases day by day. So the system should be able to scale on itself to large number of users. Then another one is message ordering. Ordering of the messages is a very important thing in chat messaging applications. If I send a message to user 2 first and user 2 sends a message to me after that, so for example, if there are two messages, message 1 and message 2, I see message 1 first and then message 2, user 2 is seeing message 2 first and then message 1. So it's not a consistent behavior, right? He will see the other message first, I will see the first message first. So the ordering should be similar for both the users. Other than that, let's see what's the scale that we are trying to solve for. How many users, how many messages will be there. So we are trying to solve for the users to be 100 million. It can be like somewhere around 1 billion, like WhatsApp has 1 billion users. So our users will range, number of users will range from 100 million to 1 billion. We are trying to solve for 100 million, but we'll also consider the scale as to be 1 billion. So if the scale increases to 1 billion tomorrow, the system should be able to handle it. Let's say each user sends 10 messages daily. So overall, the messages sent will be 1 billion to 10 billion. So yeah, these are the two numbers that we are trying to solve. So since there are 100 million users and 10 messages each user is sending, so around 1 billion or 10 billion messages that each day we are sending, right? So 10 billion messages per day is like a huge number, and that's why we have to scale our system properly, right? So let's start. Let's start with a very basic system. Let's say there are two users, user 1 and user 2. They both have their app running on the mobile. And there is one chat server. So that chat server is responsible for sending messages from one user to another. And there is one small TV which this chat server is keeping with itself to store the messages. So let's see how our first requirement will work. User 1 will start sending the message. He opens the app. He type the message, he sends the message to the chat server. It can be, let's say, HTTP right now, since there is no, it can be HTTP right now. He sends a HTTP request to the chat server. Chat server will receive the message and he will have to send the message to the YouTube, and also he will persist the message into the TV. Now, how will chat server will send the message to YouTube? They are getting multiple ways. One way could be a pull mechanism and one way could be a push mechanism. In pull mechanism, what YouTube will do, YouTube will keep on polling the chat server. It's called like normal polling, like after every 2 seconds, 5 seconds or whatever threshold amount of time the YouTube has configured. After every that much amount of time, YouTube will ask the chat server if there are any pending messages for this user. If there are any pending messages for this user, chat server will send the messages back into this request. It can be an HTTP request which YouTube will make. And if there are no messages, then chat server will simply say there is no messages. So YouTube will again poll it again after, let's say, 5 seconds, right? Now the issue with this approach is you want your messages to be sent in real time as possible, right? So over here what happened was you won't send the message at T1 at first second, YouTube received it at 5th second, because that was the time when it polled, and then it will reply his response back. So that's the that's the main problem, that's why you cannot use pull mechanism. So because of this reason you have to use push mechanism. In the push mechanism, what will happen is server will push the message directly to YouTube. Now the problem is, how will it do this? There is no connection that YouTube, I mean there is no way you stack server can connect YouTube directly, right? YouTube was able to make a HTTP request because some server running listening on some port for the HTTP request, so that's why YouTube was able to make HTTP request to chat server. But how chat server will directly connect to YouTube? There is no server running on YouTube at YouTube's end. So how this will work is, there are two ways to solve this problem. One is long polling and another one is TCP connections. Persistent TCP connections, what you call it, common word is web sockets. So in the first solution, long polling, what happens is YouTube, instead of chat server sending an empty response in the HTTP request which YouTube made, what will happen when YouTube make a HTTP request to the chat server? The chat server, if it has the data available to be sent to YouTube, it will directly reply back and send the response back to YouTube on that HTTP request. But if there are no pending messages to be sent to YouTube, what chat server will do? It will hold on to that connection instead of sending an empty response. So when let's say YouTube sends a HTTP request asking for messages, chat server has none, so it will hold on to that HTTP connection. Now let's say U1 or some other user sends a message for YouTube. Now the chat server knows I already have a connection for YouTube, so chat server directly send a response back on that HTTP connection. It might happen that chat server or the YouTube waits for some amount of time, let's say some amount of seconds, and then the connection HTTP request timed out, so the connection will disconnect, and YouTube will again make a whenever the connection disconnects, YouTube will instantly make another request to the chat server. So there is always a connection open with the chat server, and whenever the chat server has a data on this for this user, the response will come back. Also, when YouTube receives a response for the request, it will again instantly make a request for the next response. So that is how long polling works. Over here, the issue is you have to make multiple number of TCP connections, because with every HTTP request, there is a TCP connection, new TCP connection that is being made. So which will take more amount of time because there are more number of round trips. So we will prefer, there is another way called TCP connections, which is web sockets. So in this case, YouTube will make a persistent TCP connection with the chat server. And this TCP connection is capitalized by sending ping pong messages on the server, so that both the client, both the parties know the connection is alive. And whenever chat server or YouTube want to send something to each other, they will use this connection. So it's a bi-directional channel. Whenever chat server has something to send, so it will send it on this channel, so YouTube will receive it. And whenever YouTube has something to send, it can also write it on the channel and chat server will receive. So now let's see how the overall flow works with the TCP connections. So let's say they are U1. U1 makes a TCP connection with the server, and U2 also makes a TCP connection with the server. So whenever U1 wants to send a message to U2, U1 will again write the same message on the TCP connection now. Child server will receive it. Now, child server will need to keep a mapping of like which connection is possible for which user. So it will need to use some hash table, right? Where he will keep mapping from user to connection. So that it knows like this connection is for U2 and this connection is for U1. So when U1 sends a message to U2 to the child server will receive M. And now child server will find out like the message destined for U2. So it will ask this hash table like, give me the connection for U2. It will find the connection and it will write the message for U2 on this connection. U2 will receive it. And that's how the message will get delivered to U2. So one-on-one chat works fine with a simple server. And first non-function requirement is also met. But how about the second one? How the system should scale, right? If there are so many users connected to the same server will not be able to handle all the connections, right? A single chat server should be fairly able to handle 50,000 connections at least, and the WhatsApp and other systems, other companies have made their servers so custom, like they have played around with kernel and all, so what's best to handle around a million connections. But let's say our chat server is able to handle single chat server is able to handle 50,000 connections. So a single chat server will be able to handle 50,000 users, right? Because each user is making one connection. But we have 100 million users and, you know, maybe to 1 billion users. So how will that work? So we have to use multiple chat servers, right? So let's see how multiple chat servers work. Okay, so now instead of one chat server, you have multiple chat servers. And whenever the user connects to one of the chat servers, so let's say U1 connects to CS1 and U2 connects to CS2. So whenever the connection happens to chat server, the chat servers are maintaining a common cache and they are putting it right like which user is connected to which chat server. So whenever there is a connection request from to CS1, CS1 will put a entry into the cache and it will enter like U1 is connected to CS1. Similarly, there is an entry in the cache like U2 is connected to CS2. So now what happens is whenever U1 wants to send some message to U2, the message will come to CS1. CS1 will see the connection, the message destined for U2, and it will check the cache, which is the chat server responsible for U2, and it will connect it will connect CS2 to send message to U2. And CS2 is it's holding the connection for U2, it is able to send the message to U2. So this is how message routing will work when you have multiple servers. You can distribute the load among your servers using consistent hashing. There can be a common router which can route the users, like which box it connects to, and that router can keep track of new chat servers as the scale increases, and it can use consistent hashing to distribute the load among chat servers, because these chat servers are sticky, right? If a user is connected to one box, then those user messages will always be sent to that box only, right? And that's how you are partitioning your users among the chat servers, right? If the logic of this cache, I'm storing the key value user to server mapping in the cache becomes too complicated, then we can maybe take this out into a separate service. Maybe we can put this into the router service because this already knows which user is mapped to which server, or we can put it into a separate service called session service where it is stored like which user's session is stored on which server. But that depends on the load that you get or the complexity that your chat server engages to. But right now it becomes okay to keep the cache along with this chat server only. So yeah, that's how your scale will work and you are able to increase the number of users. Now let's try to solve it for group chat. Now let's say we have groups into the system and each group can have any number of members. Let's not limit the number of users. We can recommend the users to have less number of members in the group. But since the apps like Slack or Microsoft Teams, those sort of apps which are business oriented or enterprise apps, they cannot. They generally do not limit the number of users in a single group. So let's try to keep our system flexible. So we'll allow infinite number of We can have some hard limit like 10,000 or so, but we can allow as many number of members, like large number of members in the groups. So there will be a separate group service which will be having 1 GB of its own. It is responsible for handling the groups. So whenever there is a group request comes in for like create group, the chat server will send the request to the group service to create a group and store it in the database. Now as you can see, the chat server was mainly responsible for sending messages, chat messages from one user to another, right? Now it is also handling the groups messages. So this is not a good idea to do this. So what we can instead do is we can have a separate session service, and the users will now actually connect to session service, and session service will keep the record of which user is connected to which session box. Session box 1, session box 2. This is a multiple partition service, and this is the persistent TCP connection. So users are now making persistent connection with the session service and not the chat service, and session service will depending on which type of message it is. So now what will happen is we can already see there are two types of messages in the system. One is the chat message, which is sending from one to another, and one is the group message, like create group message, or if there is some contact service, then get contacts message. So what we can do is at the session service itself, instead of parsing the whole message, because the message size will be larger, right? And if all the messages are passed by session service, then the amount of memory that the session service is going to take will be high, because each message is going to take some memory, and we can avoid that. What we can do is with each message we can store a type, and then it's a payload, and the type of the message can be specific for a particular service. So for example, if it's a chat message, then the type can be chat message. If it's a group message, then the type can be groups. So message received on the, when I say message, it's not a chat message, it's a normal payload or XMPP message. Actually, what XMPP is basically used for messaging, it's a messaging protocol which is used for client server communication. So whenever client wants to connect to server on a persistent connection, it can use XMPP. It's a fairly popular protocol for sending for client server communication for messaging applications. So whenever user one wants to send something to the system, like maybe chat message or groups, it sends a type along with it. And if it's a chat message, session service will get the type from the XMPP packet that it has received, and from that packet, it sees the chat message, so it can send it to the chat servers. And similarly, when it sees it's a group message, it can send it to the group servers, and the actual payload can be passed by the respective services. So the actual session service do not have to pass the whole payload. So now coming back to the problem, we have group service, and group service is able to handle the groups, like creation of groups, and it stores the information for all the groups, like who all are the members. So when a human creates, human wants to create a group, it sends a message to the session service with the type as groups. It is received on the group service. The service will store the data in its database, like this is the group and these are the members. Now let's say when human sends a message to a particular group, so it's a chat message, it will again be received on the session service. Now session service will see it's a chat message, so it will send it to the chat server. Let's say it picked one of the servers, which is chat server 1, and it's sent a group ID. Instead of chat user ID, it will be a group ID now, right? Because the message is sent to a group. So chat server will now connect to the group service, and it will ask the list of all the members of the group, for this group ID. Group service will return the members of the group to the chat server. Chat server will send that message to each of the group members via the session service again, right? Because persistent connection is with the session service only, like you were doing it for one-to-one chat earlier. Now, instead of one user, it will send it to all the users of that group. Now, as you can see over here, what can happen is, if there is some large group, right? So that chat server will become busy, right? And it can happen like there are multiple requests coming in for the same chat group, and all the chat servers get busy working on those requests, sending messages to the session service, getting the members, sending message one by one to all the services, to all the users by session service. If the load increase, those number of requests increase into your system, and you are able to see like your servers are busy, and that's why you are not able to handle the new request, because all of the servers are handling the group messages, and when you receive a new request or a new message for another user, that message will get dropped, right? Because how, because your chat servers are already busy. You can say your chat servers will scale because they have really reached their capacity, but scaling chat servers will also take some time, right? It can take some minutes or so. So in that, during that time, then your system is busy, and it might happen that you might drop some messages because you might show some error to the user because you are not able to connect to the service. So what instead you can do is, instead of directly giving it to the chat servers, instead of doing it like synchronous manner, what you can do is, you can do it in asynchronous manner. So you can have a queue over here. It can be a Kafka queue or SQS or whatever. And what will happen is, when human sends a message to a session service, there will be a chat in gesture service, chat in gesture server, which is taking the input messages, and session service will give a chat message to in gesture, and chat in gesture will directly just put it into the queue. It will not parse, or it will not send the message to someone. It will just put the message into the queue to be sent. Now, there will be multiple chat server consumers running like earlier, and now they will be pulling the messages from the queue and interacting with the group service and then the session service to send the messages. So this way your system becomes more resilient, in the sense that if the load increases for some amount of time in your system, then also you are not dropping the messages. The main problem earlier was you are not dropping the message. You were dropping the message at that time. If the message was sent from one user to another, you were not accepting it, the message. Over here, what will happen is, when the load increases on your system, the queue size will increase, which will lead to some delays in sending of the messages, but still you will at least accept the message, right? You will get the message in the gesture, and you will put it in the queue. It might happen, it will take, instead of real time, instead of some milliseconds, it takes some seconds to process the message from the queue, but your message will get sent. One more thing which you can do, which Facebook also does, is you can have priority messages in the queue. So if, let's say, there is very high load, there is some event going on, you get high load on the system. So in that case, your queue will start filling up, right? So what you can do, you can prioritize your message. So for example, messages like receipts, we'll come to receipts, we have not discussed about receipts so far. We'll come to that, but messages like receipts or like last seen messages, these are the less prioritized messages, right? So instead of prioritizing, instead of sending those messages, you can prioritize chat messages, and your queue will prioritize those chat messages, and then those chat messages will get consumed first, and other messages will get consumed later. Similarly, another thing you can do is, if there are groups you have to send messages to all of the members of the group, but if a group has, let's say, 1,000 members or 10,000 members, but only few of the members are online, right? You can get that list from the last seen service, like who are members are active out of these members in the last some time, and you can prioritize again to send messages to those services first, instead of sending it to the all the groups at once. You can prioritize sending a message to the active ones first. So those sort of heuristics you can do once you have the queuing in place. Your consumer will each of the consumer will handle the messages one by one, and they will start sending the message from the queue. Okay, so now let's come to receipts, how receipts will work. So what we have covered so far, we have covered chat one-to-one, sending messages from here, then it will again come to queue, and one of the consumer will take it up and send it to another user via the session service. Group chat again we have done, the message will come here, it will come to queue, it will be taken by some consumer, it will see it's a group members will be fresh, it will be sent to other members, considering priorities and all that we already discussed. Now let's see receipts, how receipts will work. So in the case of receipts, how many receipts will be there? One is sent, second is delivered, third is read, right? So now what will happen is, when human sends a message to the session service, and when session service is able to, the chat in gesture actually will be able to send the message to the queue, we know the message persisted into the system. We can have a persistent policy for the queue, like maybe 7 days or something. So we are sure once the message gets into the system, it will be there for the 7 days. So the chat in gesture will send a receipt back to the session service to be sent to the user one. And the message tag will be received now. There is a new message tag we have introduced, which is a receipt. And received message will be received on the client, and it will be having a sent in it, like the message ID along with the sent, like this message is sent to the server, and a single tick will be shown onto the user device. When the message is delivered to the U2, and when U2 gets sends an input, so when U1 sends a message to U2, session service will give it to chat server, right? And chat server will be sending the message to U2. Now U2 can send the acknowledgement back, its own receipt of received. So again, this message type, that the XMPP message type which U2 will send will be of type received, and it will be received in the payload. And we can either have another received service, but that looks too much for a single received kind of thing. So instead of that, chat server can itself handle the same thing, because the received and the message check go hand in hand. A message received is actually associated with a message only. So a single chat server should be able to handle it. If it becomes complex later on, we can take it out into a separate microservice in future, but right now it looks good on the same chat server. So received message will also receive over here, and received and the chat server will send a delivered message to the U1 again on the same TCP channel with the message type to be delivered, and U1 will show the double tick onto it. All the communication to both the users is happening via this TCP channel, which is connected via session service. So whoever wants to send any message to the two users, it will be using the session service. Like groups right now is not sending, it's only the chat server right now they are sending. But let's say there are some other parties in the service, in the whole architecture, where they want to send some message to the two users, they will use the session service to do that. So whenever I'm saying sending a message to two users, it's happening via session service. I just wanted to clarify that. So yeah, we have seen receive. So when receive is received over here, a delivered is sent to U1. Similarly, when U2 reads the message, U2 will send a received packet again with the red in the payload, and it will again be received on the chat server, and chat server will send it to the U1 with the red packet, and green or blue tick will be shown on the U1. So that's how you will handle receipts. The next thing, let's say last seen. So last seen, actually there can be a last seen service, and it can also subscribe to this particular queue. So whenever there is a receipt or there is a message coming on from U1, it will get notified and it can update its last seen. So it can keep a cache of its own. It can keep a TV along with a cache. It can keep the entries in the cache, and for long-term persistence, it can keep it in the DB also. Right. Since last seen is very subjective, you might not want to keep it forever. You might want to keep it only in the cache. That depends on the business. But if you want to keep it forever also, then you can keep it into the DB. But how it will store it? It will get key value pair, like user to last seen timestamp. Like when user one sends a message to session service, it will be sending a message to the Kafka queue, right? And both the chat server and as well as the last seen consumers will get the event from the queue, and both of them, chat server will do the job of its own, and last seen server will update the last seen time of the user one into its cache. Now, whenever a last seen of a user is updated, that has to be broadcasted to the other users also, right? So, for example, if U2 and U1 were chatting with each other, and U1's last seen changes, so and U2 is chatting, so U2 should get to know, right? The last seen is updated to, let's say, 2 minutes to online. So, how will that work? One way would be, whenever the last seen is updated of any user, we will send it to all the users, like, you know, like if there are 1 billion users into the system or 100 million, we send a broadcast message to all of the users, like U1 has updated its last seen, which is, as you can also see, right, it's a clear problem. Like there will be too many last seen packets going on into the system, like, so because last seen gets updated very frequently and you are broadcasting it to everyone, so your system will be, you know, loaded with last seen only, and it will go down. So we have to do better, right? We have to do it intelligently. Instead of sending it to all, we have to reduce the breadth or the number of users to which we are sending. Another way could be, like last seen, we can send to only friends. We can have a friend service where we are keeping on, like, who all are the friends of each other. So instead of sending it to all of the users in the organization or all of the users in the system, we are sending it only to the friends of one user. But again, a friends, number of friends can be large. If I have maybe 1,000 friends and I'm chatting with only 5 people, so there is no point in sending the last seen of all the 1,000 people, right? So each user has some active chats. those active checks last year you were actually interested for, because that's what you are seeing on the roster on your first team. You are interested for the last year of other users also, but that is sort of deprioritized when you see, when you go to a contact and then you click on it and then you will see the last year of the user. But for the people who are online and they are shown on the first screen with whom you are actively chatting, those last seen you need to update on the chat screen also instead of opening the chat. So there are two ways, right? One last seen is shown in the there is a user one, last seen online, you do online or not, and there is a chat screen then, which is you one online, right? So these are two places where you will show last seen. So one is active chats and one is this thing. So how to do it intelligently is, when over here it's straightforward, as you can see, when the chat is open, we can make a call to the session service, I mean on the same chat, and we can ask for the last seen of a particular user. So if you one is opening a chat for you two, we can have a you one will send a packet to session service with the chat tag to be last seen, and last seen will send session service will send the packet to the last seen service because the last seen packet. And last seen will get the last seen for you two and send some packet back to the you one with the response. So this is straightforward. But how about this thing? How will you keep a track of active chats? So do you want to use server? There is an active chat service over here who will keep a track of all the active chats for a single user. But keeping in sync will be too much work, right? And it looks very complex solution. So instead of what we can do is, like, client can actually request the last seen of all the active user after every sometime, because last seen is again very not a very real time thing. If I poll after every, let's say, 2 seconds or so for all the active chats only from the client, then I can show the last seen of the users on the app. Okay, so this is how last seen will work. Whenever there is activity from the user, the event will come onto the queue and the last seen service will update it into its own storage. It's a DB. last seen will store the last seen service will store the last seen into its storage, whether it's DB or cache, and the fetching will come from the client. Okay, so now let's come to notifications first, then we'll come to chat issue. So for the notifications, if two people are chatting with each other and one goes offline, and that is the app gets killed. So we have to, so one way is, like, we can send error to the user, like the user is not online and we cannot send a message to user 2. But we can do better here. How do we do that? So what does that mean? If the user 2 is not online, there is no TCP connection made, right? If the user 2 is online, there is a TCP connection made. Or so basically the TCP connection which is used to connect server to the client is not available. That's why we are saying U2 is offline. It might be because of the app, app is in the killed state, or user forcefully killed the app. For some reason, the user 2 is not online. So what we will do is, we will actually use something called notification service. So there is a new service coming up in the system which is called notification service. And this service will be responsible for sending the notification to the user. So now what will happen is, session service, when it sends a packet to the client onto the TCP connection, it will wait for the acknowledgement for some time. So for example, it waits for the acknowledgement for, let's say, some amount of seconds, and if the acknowledgement comes up, then it is good, it marks the packet to be delivered to the other user. But if the acknowledgement does not come up, then it assumes the user to be offline or not available. That's one. Another thing is, the TCP connection is not available at all. So for example, if some chat server wants to send a message to U2 and session service finds that there is no entry for U2 into its own cache, so that means user 2 has not yet connected to the session service, right? So in both the cases, if there is no acknowledgement coming up or if there is no connection available, session service will use the notification service to send a notification to the user. Notification service will in general will in turn uses the third party providers, like if it's a GCM, if it's a Google device, Android device, then it will ask GCM to send a notification to the user. If it's an iOS device, then it will use APNS, Apple Push Notification Service, to send a notification to the user. That, as you can see, you will receive push notification on your mobile device, right? So that's how you get the push notifications. or maybe if it's an SMS, so it will connect with the SMS gateway. If it's an email that you want to send, then
it's again an emails provider that the notification service will use. So there will be multiple adapters, there will be multiple providers for the notifications, and depending on the maybe preferences of the user, it can have set in this one app, like where he wants to send get the notification, he can use, notification service can use that particular channel to send the notification to the user. Then comes the last part, is the chat history. For the chat history, if you see your pattern, so you are getting so many updates, like every time a message has to be sent, a message has to be stored for the particular chat ID. Also, there are so many reads, and the reads, as you can, if you see your read pattern, how it will happen is it will be page read, right? So give me the chat messages for like latest 15 messages, then give me chat messages for next page, like 15 messages on the next page, and so on. So what you can see, your updates are small updates, like add this message to the particular chat, and reads are page reads, right? So for both of these requirements, one database which caters best to this is HBase. HBase is optimized for these sort of queries. It is a column-wide database. It can store multiple values for a single key using multiple columns. So for chat history, we can use actually HBase over here. How that will work, that I will maybe cover in the next in some other video, because that needs a video in all together. But chat history will be stored in a HBase DB, and there will be one service with chat history, and it will be taking two requests, like add message and get history, and it will also be reading that Kafka queue that we had. And whenever there is a message into the Kafka, it will read that message from the Kafka, and it will store the message for the archival or history purpose, whatever you call it. So as you can see, Q is helping us in multiple ways. There are already three consumers: large scene, chat message, and history service. So yeah, that's how history will update its own data. Okay, so let's just talk about like resiliency of fault tolerance and scalability ones, because those are our message routing is also there, so I'll talk about that also. But let's talk about those two things first. So resiliency, as we already know, and the fault tolerance, like no data loss, since we are saying that Kafka is persisting its data, it's keeping the data for 7 days. So we once the message arrives in the system, it will not be lost, and for at least 7 days, and after 7 days we can maybe clear up or maybe increase the retention policy, something like that. But Kafka is providing us data resiliency and no data loss, so we are sure on that. Scalability, as we can see, most of our systems are already scalable. The chat servers are scalable. Chat servers are now no more technical connections, so they can scale horizontally. As the number of messages in the queue keeps on increasing, we can increase the number of consumers that we have in the system. For chat consumers, for history consumers, since history is an asynchronous process, and it is not that real time, so number of consumers for history can be less than for number of consumers for chat. But yeah, both of them can be scaled independently. Similarly, last three consumers can be scaled independently. For session service that we had over there, the data is basically handling the connections, and it is sort of providing a partitioning thing for the number of for the users who are connecting to the service, so that we can scale using consistent hashing. No more number of partitions can be introduced, and more number of users can connect to those partitions. So that service is also scaled. Group service again is it's a stateful service, but it's using its own DB. So service in itself is a stateless. The state is stored in the DB, which is the amount, which is the group's data, like group name, group metadata, members in the group. So those things are there in the DB, but group service in itself can be scaled horizontally. One number of servers can be increased. Okay, so yeah, how message ordering works now. So if two users, let's say two users are chatting with each other, user 1 and user 2, user 1 sends message 1 and user 2 sends message 2. Now we need some logic at the client device, right, to order the messages. Let's say we use timestamp, and let's say we use the timestamp at which the user 2 receives a message and user 1 creates a message in its own system. So for example, M1, user 1 sends a message at T1 to U2, and U2 sends a message at T2 to U1. So in U1 chat, let's say this is the U1 chat and this is the U2 chat. So in U1 chat, when U1 sends a message to U2 at T1, so at M1, it is sending a message at T1, and similarly M2 sends a message at T2. Or maybe let's just move it for now. So U2 receives a message, U2 also see it, show it at T1. Now U2 sends a message to U2, U1 it's M2 and T2. Similarly, U1 receives it, M2 and T2. It works fine only if the clocks of both the user's devices, client devices of both the users, is same. But clock drift is a very common problem, and it's a high chance that the two clients or the multiple servers or multiple clients will have different clocks in itself. So how do we prevent message ordering? So the problem over here is we are using client timestamps over here to order the messages. So instead of using client timestamp, what we can actually do is server timestamp. So until and unless message is sent to the server, the clients can use the client timestamp because they need something at least for some time to order the messages. But as soon as the message is sent to the server, server can attach a server timestamp with it so that all the messages are stamped by the single entity, and all the messages will then have the same ordering. So whether it's U1, U2 or some other device, same ordering will be used, which is the timestamp of the server. So that's how you can handle message ordering. So there are multiple actually topics like partitioning or replication or those sort of core concepts of our like maybe caching, like core concepts of system designing, which we cannot actually cover in when we are taking case studies like WhatsApp or something. Over there, when we have to design like what multiple parties will be there, what multiple components will be there, how they will be using the core concepts. If you want to learn about core concepts like partitioning or caching, I have already created separate videos for them. So you should watch them. For the concepts like replication and others, I have not yet created those videos. I might create them in future, or maybe you can learn those concepts from some other channel or some other video. But yeah, the idea is to when doing case study, not go deep dive into one particular component, so that not to get into a red hole, but instead is design the whole system as a whole. So if you are not sure about any specific thing, like how the partitioning, how consistent hashing works, how it will handle multiple users, how it will send multiple users to different parties, how that will remain sticky, how repartitioning will happen when a server goes down over there. For that, you will need to understand partitioning, and for that, you will need to go to a separate video, which is for partitioning. Similarly, for other concepts, there are dedicated videos for dedicated concepts. So yeah, that's how overall WhatsApp, Facebook Messenger type systems will work. Let me know your feedback and comments in the comments itself, and let me know if you have any suggestions also.